ask yourself, why did God send his son into this world? Why?
Come to Jesus tonight. Come to Jesus tonight.
Come to the Father, except he's coming through me. Hey, if it is true, if this thing is true, I said, if it is true, and it is true.
Hallelujah. We have testimonies, amen. How many of you are becoming wiser as you hear the testimonies? I want us to welcome Corby Nelson to give us his testimony. Welcome Corby Nelson as he comes to give us his testimony.
Amen. My name is Corby Nelson from UPSC level 300. It all started 20th September 2014 when Bishop came to our hostel, Prestige Hostel. We were in the nightclub. Yeah. We were in the nightclub that day, and we came out of the club and realized there was a carnival of stars. So I was telling my friends that, oh, the way of late, fresh girls are going to church here. You must also go to church. Because by then, I've lived for almost 6 to 7 years without going to church. So when Bishop was preaching, he made an altar call. In fact, it was the altar call that really moved me, because he said, you don't know the day that you die. And I was scared, because the kind of life that I was living, I was scared to die. So that day, I came forward and I gave my life to Christ. The following day, he said he's going to meet us at Central Cafeteria, so we should come. And I was in my room, and a certain girl came that we are going to go. I said I won't go unless they bring their pastor to come and call me. So I was there, and Elpi Lulu and Elpi Vadi came to the room. I was there with my friends, and she said she's waiting for us. We should go and bath. Then we were flexing. So she would take us herself. Then we went, my friend and I, Emeka, and we took our bath and we came. And that day, there was so much joy. The dancing stars. I really enjoyed myself. And when Bishop made the altar call again, I came forward again, because I was not feeling convinced that my sins could be washed just a day. Amen. The following week was Healing Jesus Crusade, and my chief elder by then, Chief Elder Bonsu, he took me to Healing Jesus Crusade, and ever since then, I became strong in the church. And after obligation camp, I called my chief elder and I said, I want to start preaching. And then he said, I will need the evangelist, the Makane. I said, okay. So he gave it to me, and I started soaking them, and I started preaching from lecture hall to lecture hall. Amen. Yeah, and by the grace of God now, I'm a shepherd and assisting Lady Pastor Blossom in a branch church. I want to thank the Lord Almighty for my life, and I want to thank Bishop Dark, for I really love you, for coming to my hostel, for that altar call. In fact, I can't live within 30 minutes in the day without listening to your voice. 30 minutes, I'm always listening, always listening. I really want to encourage all of us. The messages, they are really real. Amen.
Why don't you give the Lord a shout? People have been changed. Amen. Please help me welcome Kalipa to give us his testimony. Help me welcome Kalipa.
Amen. My name is Kalipa Solokazana. I'm a student of Anakazo Bible Seminary from South Africa. Well, my testimony is about a gift I believe God gave to me when Daddy laid his hands on me, if I'm not mistaken, 3 years back. It started, well, every year, in fact, year after year, around May. Global International Ministries likes hosting Daddy as the main speaker in Durban in a 3 or 4 day convention. And we would always make our way down from East London, driving 8 to 9 hours to the convention, hungry and yearning, even if it's just to say hello, Daddy, or just to shake his hand. But I was always disappointed because we're always going back to East London without having to get a chance to meet Daddy or to have a personal word for myself. So I started preparing for his next coming. I started praying, and I remember I took my phone and I went to sell it and some of my few gadgets to have an offering to give to sow. And the convention was just about to start, and I added a little fasting. So the first day came, no word, no hello, nothing. The second day came, nothing. And Daddy made an announcement that tomorrow is a healing service. If you know of anybody that needs a healing, be it your family, be it a friend, go and bring the person. And the third day came. Daddy was preaching on quiet time. And the service was over. He was now ministering to the people. He started praying, making calls, people to pray for. And then I didn't hear a particular call that would make me go to the front. But I just told myself that any call he is going to make next, I'm going. I don't remember the call he made, but I remember I was sitting right at the back of the hall. But surprisingly, when he made that call, I was one of the first few people to make, I found myself to the front. And then because of the large crowd that was there, he wasn't spending a lot of time when he was praying for people. So he would just touch you, and then he would move. But then he got to me, I had my hands lifted, my eyes closed. I was believing God for something. Then he just touched me, and then he moved. And then I believe the devil whispered to me that, you see, you wasted your money, you should have eaten. But then I felt that blessed hand touch me again. It was soft, it was oily, it was very warm. I don't remember all that he said, but I remember these words. He said, God has given you a gift. Embrace it. He moved on. Since that day, I've been thinking and praying to God to reveal this gift to me. And just recently, it occurred to me that I believe that gift is a gift of faith. Because I remember my pastor sent me to start a church far away from Apache in East London. I knew nobody in that town, but without analyzing, without thinking, I just jumped to the opportunity and I went and started the church. Even just recently, a door opened for me to come to Ghana for missions. I didn't know what would become of me, but when I heard missions and it's out of your country, I jumped to the opportunity and I found myself in Ghana. Having said all of that, I just want to appreciate God for my life. Without the grace of God, you are looking at a womanizer, you are looking at a drunkard, but God has worked in me so much. And Daddy, I won't be surprised when you get to heaven. Your crown, you won't be able to carry it. Because you are changing so many lives, and I'm really grateful for your life. Thank you.
Wow, powerful testimony. want us to welcome Philip Ejapon to give us his testimony. Help me welcome Philip Ejapon to give us his testimony. Oh, please welcome him as he comes to the stage, Philip Ejapon.
Hallelujah. My name is Philip Ejapon. So I have a short testimony, very, very short. So I want to thank God for my life. It's by a miracle that I'm standing here today. It was 27th of January, a Wednesday night. I was just leaving work. I was going to get some food to eat. So I got into a taxi. And then I usually don't sit in the front seat of a taxi. I usually sit in the back seat of a taxi. So, but then for some strange reason, I decided to sit in the front seat. I was telling my pastor that I think I heard a voice, like, sit in the front seat. So I sat in the front seat of the taxi, went through Circle, Kwame Nkrumah Circle. There was a roadblock for some strange reason. Then the taxi driver said, okay, then you go through Graphic Road. I'm like, okay, that's fine. I'm hungry, so let's keep it moving. Let's go fast. So I'm going through Graphic Road, through Crowd Tech, and then up to Acropolis. There's like a little intersection. I was on the phone with my cousin. And then as soon as I was still talking on the phone with my cousin, I turned to my right-hand side, there was a huge Metro Mass bus coming top speed at us. All I remember was a huge crash. So then, for like, it must have been like 10 minutes, I woke up, nothing. I woke up surprised. I didn't know where I was. I was in total shock. So I'm there thinking, wow, like, what's really happening? So all I felt was like the sprinkling water on my face. And then my door couldn't open. So they had to drag me out from the other side where the driver was. So I got up. I was happy. I was happy that I was alive. Basically, I was telling everybody around me to calm down. I said, listen, everybody should calm down. Just let me know where I am, what's really happening. So then I misplaced my phone. I remember any phone numbers. A good Samaritan, I'd say he's an angel, just picked me up, took me to the hospital, Ridge Hospital. And I mean, I just had a stitch. They just did like small stitch on my arm. And then this is the amazing part of the story. The taxi driver that was rather sitting on the left-hand side where the impact wasn't, he rather had like a fractured neck. He was in a cast, and it doesn't make any sense at all. I'm here telling this testimony because I'm very grateful to Bishop Dag for writing this book, Demons and How You Can Deal With Them. Because the Sunday before, my pastor preached about how Satan wants to kill you. And I'm like, within 3 days, it happened live. Like, he didn't even wait for a month or 2 weeks or something. No. Because Satan really wants to kill you. I was totally surprised that physically I was about to be killed. So that on that Sunday, another amazing thing was that after the whole service, there was my pastor preaching. He said, no, he wants us to continue praying. He said, This wouldn't be the year that you die. I thought, oh, okay, I receive it. So this is the year that you live. I'm like, oh, okay, it's powerful prayers. But then on the Wednesday, the prayers really came to pass, and I'm here today on my second life. That's what I call it. So thank you very much to God. Thank you very much to Bishop Dag for writing that book. Satan does really want to kill us. We should be very, very prayerful. Amen. Thank you.
Oh, put your hands together for Philip. Want us to welcome Kojo Amwako to give us his testimony. Help me welcome Kojo Amwako to give us his testimony.
My name is Joseph Amuako, a student of Anakazu Bible Ministry Training Center. Amen. It all started in the year 2010 when I had scholarship to study in the Philippines in Southeast Asia. But when I got there, after my pre-medical course in biomedical science, I had a call from the agency that they can't sponsor me any longer. So I became very frustrated and I didn't know what to do. So I decided to go to Singapore, work and come back to finish my course. But when I traveled to Singapore, at the airport, they asked me for money, $10,000, $1,000, but I didn't have it. I was having only $600. They told me that they can't let me enter. So I went back to Philippines, and upon getting to the airport, they said, no, I have to go back to Ghana. I said, wow. So they kept me at the airport for 3 days because I have to arrange for plane tickets to come back to my country. But thanks be to God, there was an arrangement and I was able to buy a ticket and I came back to Ghana. And when I came, I decided to go back to Thailand to work, to find money. So that I could go back to Philippines to finish my medical course. Because I told myself that this is what I want to become. And my biomedical science was not enough. I wanted to become a medical doctor. So when I finished with the visa, I went back to Nigeria for visa because they don't have embassy in Ghana. I went all straight to Abuja. And I even, the car that I sat in, one of the Thai God best. So when I got a visa, I came back to Ghana. And when my plane ticket was ready, the visa too has expired. So I decided to go to Malaysia. Hallelujah. So I sent my passport to the agency and they sent my passport to the embassy and I got a Malaysian visa. And it was left with a ticket again. So I called my friend in Thailand and he bought a ticket with his credit card. And when the ticket came, it was left with 6 days for my Malaysian visa to expire. And a friend advised me that I shouldn't go because if I go, I may be frustrated and it will turn to a different thing. So I didn't go. So I went back to my reverend and he told me that, Joseph, you have a calling. But I ignored it. One night, I had a dream. And the dream, I found myself in the anatomy and physiology lab. We were dissecting cadaver. That's a human body that we use for the practicals. And a voice told me that, you are not supposed to be here, but you are supposed to be behind the pulpit. And I rebuked the voice because I said, this is not a good voice. I rebuked it. I told myself, this is not a good voice because my ambition is to become a medical doctor. And nothing can stop me because I spent 1 year in Philippines to learn their language, which is Tagalog. And I was able to flow all because of medicine. So I went back again to my reverend. I told him that, looking at the way things are, I may find myself in a situation whereby it will be disastrous. So I want to surrender and go back to the Bible school and to be trained to become a pastor. So I took the recommendation letter. I came here. And I was admitted, and thanks be to God, I was told that it's a full scholarship given by daddy. And I was so glad, I was so happy that here I am by the grace of God. Daddy, thank you very much. And God richly bless you that today I stand here and I believe that one day I'll become a very great missionary. And I wouldn't mind to go back to Asia. If I could risk my life for medicine, I'll risk my life for the cause of Jesus Christ. Thank you very much. Bless you.
Hallelujah. How many of you are so blessed by the testimony? We are becoming wiser. Amen. I'm so glad to announce to you that it's time for the
Hallelujah. Let us pray. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. We know we are lost without you. We know we don't have direction without you. We know that you are guiding us today. Let your will be done. Thank you for your great blessing. We ask for the mighty Holy Spirit to be with us. Guide us in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. It's exciting to be back here. We're bringing you greetings from South Africa, where we've been for some time. Preaching all over the country there. And the Lord was with us. We are back safely by God's grace. Amen. Happy Valentine's Day. Is that what you're supposed to say? And what's the reply? I was born before Valentine was important. It's BBV, born before Valentine. But it's supposed to be a time of love. Wow. May we enjoy this wonderful love. Amen. Today I want to share with you a few things that I believe are going to be important. Now, before I do, I want to make a couple of announcements. Amen. That I believe are very important for us. Amen. This meeting that we are having here is what I call a monthly first love celebration. So, we are going to have this meeting once in a month, but we are not sure which Sunday it will be. It can be the first, it can be the second, it can be the third, it can be the fourth, but it will have to come on in the month, all right? So, what it means is that on that day, of the day of the celebration, first love, so we are celebrating the love of God. On that celebration time, all of us in the First Love churches will come together, and we start on Saturday night, not on Sunday. So those who are from outside Accra will be able to rather come on Saturday, yes, and then on Sunday after, then you can go back. So it makes it easier, and we also have places to sleep here, so you can sleep. It's free for those of us who are in First Love Church. So make sure that you are part of the First Love. When it's a First Love celebration Sunday, you must be there. So Saturday is when we have our first service, Saturday night. So during the Saturday night service, especially focusing on those who are very serious with the Lord and serious in the ministry. Amen. So all of us should be here because I believe all of you are serious. All unseriousness is declared banished from your life today. Amen. What do you think? Is it powerful? Now, because we are going to spend the whole day here, we are here for a time. If you don't like God and then church, you may have to join another church. You get it? You may have to join another church. But I know that you like God. Anyone who doesn't like God, you are healed from that curse. Because the first commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart. So From Saturday and Sunday, we are starting what I call the counseling. If you remember last year, I mentioned that everybody is going to be counseled, and we are going to start today. So the first 50 or 100 people will be counseled. I'm counseling you personally. Then I'll take a picture with you also. Amen. So you must make sure that you are experiencing the counseling. I have to counsel you. I have to give you a word. Are you listening? That is very important for your life. Amen. So personal counseling, at least the first 100, it's not going to take a long time, but that face-to-face meeting is very important. And I have to also lay hands, so either during the counseling or during our celebration, you must not be laid hands on less than 6 times this year alone. There must be a lot of laying on of hands so that the wisdom will drive out foolishness from you in Jesus' name. Whatever is declared as foolishness today is canceled in Jesus' name. Are you listening? So, very important for you to do that. Also, the music groups. We are going to have, you know, I like music, and I think music is very important in the house of God. So, the auditioning of people as well as practice. So, we are here. Those who don't like church, don't like God and all those kind of things, you may find it difficult to stay in the church. Ask your neighbor. Neighbor, I know it's not you that he's talking about. In Jesus' name. Amen. So that is a blessing. All right? And don't forget, all those who are in the church, you know, we have schools that we have. School of Victorious Living, School of the Word, School of what? Solid Foundation, and School of Apologetics, and New Believer School. You know, our church is like a school. It's not really a church in the way you may think, with gowns and other things. You get it? It's like a school. It's like an army. And so you must go through the school. So every Sunday, we are from next Sunday, we are presenting certificates. You must get a lot of certificates if you are in the church. So every Sunday, we'll be presenting. I will not present it personally, but I will sign all of them. So once you get your School of the Word, School of Victorious, because there are a lot of things you don't know. And so you must know them. A School of the Word is very important. School of Solid Foundation, School of Victorious Living, and School of Apologetics. Apologetics is about different religions and Christianity. So it helps you to understand the different things that people believe. And then what you also believe. And then why you also believe what you believe. Because there are a lot of strong religions all over the place. So you must learn more things so that you are very strong in your Christian faith. And then those who are also in the shepherding schools and pastoral schools, you must also do the schools and then pass your exam. So make sure you are part of all things. Nobody here should be big. You know, I don't like to be in a church and somebody standing outside. So we know what he's saying. So we are standing outside. That attitude can also have it in the church, where it's like you are in the church, but whatever is going on in the church, you don't actually participate in it. It's like you are above it. It's like sort of like you know everything. Then it should be better for you to go to a more advanced church where you don't know everything, so that you join the things that are in the church. What do you think? Is it fantastic? So make sure you do that. Then also, after church, all those who are grown-ups in this church, I'm forming a new group called First Love Elder Brothers. So if you know that you are here and you are grown up, you get it, immediately after church, all elder brothers, we are forming a fellowship where we will all be to form ourselves and know. Because a lot of people are trying to join the First Love Church who are grown-ups. Uh-huh. So when you have grown-ups, sometimes maybe you want to dance, then the way the grown-up will look at you, then you won't dance again. And even I've noticed that first lovers are no more dancing as they should. Whatever keeps you from dancing, whatever rope is around your leg, I cut it off today in the name of Jesus. When you are in the house of God, this is the place we can dance. Hallelujah. So it's not only the dancing stars who are going to dance for us. We are all going to dance. And those of us who are even older, maybe we are not able to have moves, it means you are in the elder brothers fellowship. But the elder brothers fellowship cannot dominate the church. The church is for children. If you are a grown up, you must know that it's a special visa as of acceptance that has been given to you. Do you understand what I'm saying? Uh-huh. But the church is for people that are young and who have energy. Yes. Wow. No, there is a difference between a young person and an older person. The older people will not admit it. But if they will admit it, they will tell you that the bones are not the same. Are you listening to me? And then don't forget the word amen. It's a word you must learn to scream amen. When you receive a word from the Lord and you hear something good that is coming your way, don't forget to scream amen. Because I don't want any blessing to pass through any of the doors or even to be able to pass from the front to the back. Hey, you must be receiving the prophecies and the words. Like our brother said, you know, Bible says in Psalm 119 verse 24, thy testimonies are my counselors. Yes, thy testimonies are my delight and my counselors. You see, you will, when they say, oh, you will not die this year, you are blessed, this and that, you will think that it's just a saying, you know. But as you get older, you will see that you know why older people are more quiet. Yes, they are calmer because they are more conscious of certain things that you are not conscious of. Yeah, they are more conscious of things. And when you stay around, you see things happening, you will not believe that it is life that you are in. So when you hear blessings, you see that people that are wise, you know, they receive. Now, the reason I'm saying this is because real faith is like you are joking. That's real faith. You see, when you sat on your chair, you never expected it to break. You see, so you sit very casually. That is, you really have faith in the chair. That is why you sat down on the chair without even thinking. So when you hear good things and wonderful things and you keep saying amen and you keep declaring them over your life, it's like a joke. You no more think about it. It becomes more real rather than saying, I believe I have a Toyota. I believe I have a Toyota. You say it 150 times. I believe I have a Toyota. When you don't, it's because you don't believe you have a Toyota. That's why you are even saying it 150 times. But the day that you say casually and without even thinking, I have a Toyota. Yes. That is the day that you have faith. And what you say in your heart and you believe with your mouth, with your heart, you believe it will happen. Other than that, you are not saved. Your salvation depends on this principle, that you believe in your heart and you say it with your mouth. Your whole salvation depends on that. So if you doubt it, you are doubting even your salvation. So when you believe in your heart and you say something with your mouth, it's very powerful. That's how people get married. You say, do you take this one as a... I do. Do you take whatever I do? Will you always do that? I will. Will you always say, I will? Amen. You are married. That's it. A very big thing happens by just saying, I do. Okay, I will. Yes. Will you do? Yes. Amen. That's all. Suddenly your status has changed. Whatever is keeping your status at the lower level is being removed in Jesus' name. God is changing your status by your faith and the things that you say. Amen. So, please, don't forget. You suddenly see that your life is changed by a word of your mouth. And that is the way it is going. Amen. So let us believe greatly in our laying on of hands. What you say amen to, say it well. Don't just say, oh, okay. That's wonderful. No. Say amen. And don't say, hey, say amen. I believe that. Yeah. Amen is different from A. A is also nice, but amen is the one that is taking it. Hallelujah. Yeah. Wonderful. So let's get on with, I'm going to teach about the two groups that exist in the world. And you'll be in the better group. Yeah. Hey, I said you will be in the better group. Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. And verse 24. And he said unto them, take heed what you hear. With what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again. And unto you that hear, unto you that hear, all right, shall more be given. Amen. And verse 25. For he that hath, to him shall be given. Amen. And he that has not, from him shall be taken even that which he hath. Wow. This verse gives us the two groups. The groups who have and the groups who have not. He that hath and he that hath not. You will be among those who have. Is there anybody got an empty chair by you? Some three people standing there. Lift your hand if you got an empty chair. Come in. Walk quickly. Anywhere where you see a hand, just walk. Nearer the front is even better. Come nearer the front. Go, come to the front. It's better. He that hath and he that hath not. That is what Ghana is made up of, he that has and he that has not. That is what every country is made up of, he that has and he that hath not. Is it not true? So, what I am sharing with you is to help you to become one of the he that hath team. He that hath. Yes, that's the group I want you to be in. He that have. Everything, you know, that can be had, you will have it. So, you must decide by the power of God to become this person. For he in that Mark 4, the first he, is he that hath. You are going to be in that group. Because there's another group. There's another group there. He that hath not. He hath not. Is another group. Every country is made of these two groups. Every church has these two groups. Every school you attend will have these two groups. Is it not true? Don't you remember when you were in school? There is the he that hath. And there's the he that hath not. Isn't it? At Legon, there is the he that hath. And he that hath not. True or not true? In tech, there is the he that hath group. He that hath. And he that hath not. At your workplace, the same job, the same building. The same building. You will see within the same building, there are four floors. There is in that building, he that hath. And in the same building, he that hath not. They are all there. Your destiny is sure. I say, your destiny is sure. You will be among the he that hath. Amen.
Amen.
Sit down. Yes. Okay. So, that's why I want to lay hands on you. Because I want to pray for you until you switch groups. Yes. Completely. Amen.
Yeah.
Amongst grown-ups, you see, amongst students, we have the two groups. There are students who have, and students who have not. When I was in school, I was he that hath. Yes. My father gave me more money than when I started to work. My salary as a doctor was less than my pocket money. Yes. And my father gave me a brand new car when I was in school. Brand new. So I was in he that hath in school. Because many people didn't have anything. And money. You get it? Now, when you come out of school, we also have workers who are in these two groups. Because many of you in school feel that when I finish school, I will join automatically he that hath. But it's not like that. In the workers group also, we have the two groups. He that hath and he that hath not. Yeah. You are in the better group. And I am going to teach you and preach to you and lay hands on you and counsel you until you are clearly far from the border. The border of he that hath and he that hath not. Can I have an amen? One of the most difficult things in the world is to prosper. Yes. If you look closely, you see that even those who have finished school, It's not as you thought it was. Sometimes you even wonder that when you were a student, you have more money than when you were working. You wait and see. So, ladies and gentlemen, I really believe this very complicated and complex ability, do you see, comes from God. Because the real secret to flourishing and prospering and joining this first He That Hath, to join that group, it comes from God. And you know, the Bible says, labor not to be rich. In other words, don't even try. Labor not to be rich. Many are laboring to be rich and are still not becoming rich. Hey! Then the Bible gives a very wonderful, mysterious reason for riches. It says, the blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich. The blessing of the Lord. Wow. The blessing of the Lord. Look at the verse, Proverbs 10:22. You can see it on the screen. The blessing of the Lord. It. The word is it. It. What is the it? The it is the blessing. So you read the Bible and you find that people who became rich had a certain blessing on their lives. Yes, Abraham, the Lord blessed him. The Lord blessed Abraham. And anybody, Jacob, Isaac, he blessed him and he became rich and he increased. And that is how come you notice that Jews, whatever they seem to be doing, mysteriously, it becomes a lot. So behind it all, you have this mysterious blessing of the Lord that makes a person rich. But this blessing of the Lord, you see, many people don't recognize the power of God, because the power of God comes through, when the power of God, and most of the power of God comes through the wisdom of God. Most of the electric power we have comes through the wisdom of electricity. Most of the power. Like the power that is powering these lights. The power that we are using to hear. It comes through the wisdom and the revelation of electricity. The electric bulb. Electric power. Energy. That's how the power comes to us. The power comes through the revelation. And the power comes through the wisdom. And the power comes through all that. You know, in Isaiah, many people don't know, like in Isaiah 59, I believe, he says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against the enemy. Now, many people do not understand. Can you put that verse up? Is the man, is it Emmanuel who is doing this? I don't think so. Solomon, fast with your scriptures. Now, you find out that when the enemy is attacking you, even if it is, what do you call it? Sickness. Huh? Do you get it? Let's say you are attacked with sickness. As many people are attacked with sickness or problems. Okay? What does the Bible say? The Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard. Now, what is the Spirit of the Lord? The Spirit of the Lord is the Spirit of wisdom, knowledge, understanding, which is like science. Do you see? Now, that word standard will lift up a standard. That word standard is a word which means like something like an escape or an exit. And it also means to cause to disappear. So when the enemy comes against you, through the spirit of wisdom, knowledge, it will, that thing that is coming against you will be caused to disappear. It's like as if it is not there. Yeah. Many of us would not be alive if the enemy of death have not been caused to disappear by the wisdom of the spirit of knowledge, the spirit of wisdom. Many of us here would not be alive. You would not have survived even childbirth, malaria, and many, many diseases. And many people have many diseases. Asthma, hypertension, sickle cell disease, epilepsy, madness, diabetes. All these are caused to disappear. Like, it's as if it's not there. By the spirit of knowledge, spirit of understanding, spirit of wisdom. So people think that medicine is like, when you take medicine, it's like you are forsaking God. Or like God is not part of it. But where does the knowledge come from? You see, it's the knowledge and the wisdom that causes many of these things to disappear. And people who joke with the spirit of wisdom, spirit of knowledge, spirit of understanding, they welcome enemies to their houses. Yes. They welcome a lot of enemies to their homes and actually cause these enemies to reside and take up residence. Because you wouldn't lift up a standard, or I like one of the explanations of that word, to cause to disappear. Like to cause the malaria to disappear. To cause the sickness that has come to disappear. Whatever is trying to kill you is disappearing today in Jesus' name. Yes. Yes. As if it didn't come. And many, 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 many great, wonderful things that, not wonderful, but evil things that seem to be happening or want to attack you. This is the magic key, the Holy Spirit. You see, wisdom doesn't look powerful. It looks, oh, do this or do this, then you'll be wise. But it, like I said, that the electric power, which if any of us touch, we'll all die. It comes from the spirit of knowledge, wisdom, understanding, revelation, light. Light. That's why the Bible says, arise, shine. Arise and start shining in this life. Because light has come. Your light has come. Light, revelation, knowledge has come. Arise and shine. Yes, you shine from today. You'll be a shining star. Because light and revelation is coming to you. So, you know, God has given me a great revelation of a number of scriptures in the Bible. That revelation is something God has taught me. And you see, as my spiritual children, it is in your interest to walk in that light. Yes. Because the light is for all of us to walk in. Yes, it is in your interest to walk in the light that has been given. Because, you know, many of these things are supernatural. In fact, perhaps because some of them seem to come casually, you will not realize the supernatural element. Like John said, the Lord sent and signified it unto me by his angel. Most of the time when there are revelations, it is sent and signified by the angel of the Lord. That is why when he was sending messages to the churches, each time there was an angel about it. So it's right to the angel, right to the angel. Because angels are greatly involved in what we are doing. Some of the stars you see in the sky are angels. When you read the Bible, you say, and I saw a star fall out of heaven, and he had a key and he opened the pit. Yes, some of the stars that you see, they're blinking. Some of them are angels. The star had the key and came to open the pit. Yeah. They are blinking like that. They are stars. You have no idea what a star is when you see it. It's fantastic. And the sun is one of the small stars. Antares is 1,000 bigger. Arcturus, 1,000, 2,000 times bigger than the sun. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's nothing. We have no idea what we are dealing with. Yeah. So when you come to this earth, yeah, when you come to this earth, you must believe. You see, because God wants to give you and myself light to walk on. Even in the short time that I've been in the First Love Church, those who have not taken the light seriously have suffered for it. Yes. In the short time that I've been here. Many people say, Bishop, whatever you say, I will do. But when you say, they don't do. When I was in South Africa recently, I tried that. Whatever you say, I'll do. I tried a number of times. And a number of people. I'll do what you say. But it is not true. There are some people, what you say they will do. So learn it. Because God has a great plan for us. Now, one of the most terrible evils in this world is the evil of poverty. Almost every bad thing is associated with poverty. Yes. Poverty is like a disease that befalls large sections of the world. Huh? You'll never have that disease. And that poverty is what Jesus described in Mark 4:25 when he says, "He that hath not." He that has not is equal to poverty. Well, you don't have. You don't have shirts. You don't have shoes. You don't have cars. You don't have money. You don't have dresses. You don't have phones. You don't have iPads. You don't have dollars. You don't have CDs. You don't have rents. You don't have anything. He that hath not. It's a big group in the world. And it is not easy to move from he that hath not to he that hath. Remember that Solomon said, wisdom in his left hand is riches, in his right hand is long life. Revelation and light makes you rich as well. God is not against riches. Oh. God is not against riches. At all. But God is against misrepresenting him. As far as riches are concerned. Now. God has not made me poor. I am not a poor person. There's nothing poor about me. Following God has not made me poor. Yes. Following God has not made me poor at all. Yes. And following God will not make you poor. Like father, like son. You didn't hear it. I said like father, like son. Your destiny is a glorious destiny. Amen. Now, the enemy has come in like a flood. Isaiah 59, verse 19. A flood, when you say flood, it's like it affects the masses. It's not a stream which is in one line, but it's a flood. A And the flood has flooded a lot of people, okay, are flooded with this flood of great difficulty. Great difficulty in surviving, in living. He that hath not. So, it is so high that in my book, when I myself read my book, he that hath, to him shall be given. He that has not, even what he has will be taken away. I am amazed at the depth of things that are in it. Yes. And no, there's nobody in this room, and even those listening to me, who know what is in that book. Yes. But it is a great light God has given me. You are standing in what, perhaps probably the largest private tertiary institution campus built. Yes. In the country. Yes. It's a light. If you've been around, it is. Yeah. Yes. You are part of the largest charismatic church. Yes. From north to south of Ghana. You may not know that you are in it. That's it. That's what's happening practically. He that hath. Yes. What you used to call our headquarters, the Kodesh, is now a branch. It's now a branch. The Kodesh is now one of our, because once I'm not there, that's not the headquarters. Yeah. This is the headquarters. Yeah, the headquarters. Yes. Yes. The quarters of the head. You are looking at the author, African author, the largest selling, widest selling author in Africa. Yes. You may not know that. Yeah. You may not know that because we don't say it, we don't talk that way. But I'm saying this for you to really look upon. I say, he that hath. He that hath churches or buildings or cathedrals or members or money. Hey. And he that hath not is a flood. You are out of the flood. You are out of the flood. You are out of the flood. Hey. Sit down. The largest crusades in Africa today. You are looking at the evangelist who is conducting those crusades all over Africa. Yes. African evangelist. Yes. But you may not know. Sit down. I am telling you this so that you would, your eyes will be tuned and you will not be deceived by my batik shirts. When you see me walking with Charlie Water somewhere. Yes. Don't be deceived. Yes. He that hath, and he that hath not. Are you listening to me? It is one of the most important and significant revelations, and everybody must have this particular book. I'm teaching you from the book. And I want you to believe, as you hold the book, that whatever is in the book, whatever light is in the book, will practically be part of your life. Practically. Practically. Not that it will be a theory somewhere that is not manifesting in your life, but it will be practical. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Now, the flood of poverty is not only in Africa. It's across. You see, the glitter and the pictures you see on CNN and on the news are very deceptive about what is happening there. If you take South Africa, South Africa looks, when you arrive at the airport, you feel that you are in Holland. When you first get there, you think that you are in Holland. But if you work there, you see that it's one of the poorest countries, even from our offerings. The lowest offering of all the countries we've ever been to is from South Africa. The lowest, yeah, the poorest. But it looks the richest, but it's the poorest. Yes, amazing. It looks like the richest, but our experience is that it's the poorest. Yes. Amazing. It's not what somebody is telling me. I don't look at figures, but right, you can have a crowd like this. We take an offering at a crusade. You get 300. One of our crusades, we had $357. Big crowd. Sometimes the security van that comes for the security van that comes for, it costs more to pay them than the offering that we received. Yes. That's why some people don't even take offerings at crusades. But compared with the different countries, Senegal, Mali, Liberia, Sierra Leone, oh, this is the lowest. So you see they are rather have a lot of pride about something. But actually, the flood has flooded out the whole place. Even in Europe and America, you will see that when your relative goes there, he rarely comes back. You haven't noticed it? You haven't noticed that when your relatives go to America, 18 years, he has never been back home. Huh? Amazing. And they'll send you pictures that they are in America. But what has happened is that many of them have joined He That Has Not in America. So I want you to, each key that I share with you, each key that I share with you, always bear at the back of your mind that the master key to any kind of prosperity is the blessing of the Lord. And that blessing of the Lord, the Bible teaches to me, my master key for my life, which is a light for us, is seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all other things will be added. No matter what work you are doing, seeking first the kingdom of God, because even pastors don't seek first the kingdom of God. Pastors don't seek the kingdom of God first. Many pastors seek money first. If I was seeking money, I wouldn't have gone to South Africa. If I was seeking money, I wouldn't do certain things. If I was seeking money, my books would be a business. But my books are not a business. If I was seeking money, would find me in places where they are supposed to have money. That is not what I'm. You see that I'm in all kinds of places. So, brothers and sisters, the master key, the blessing of the Lord is actually, so Jesus will not share his glory with anyone. So no matter the keys that are taught, the glory and the praise and the thanksgiving for life and blessing and prosperity comes from him. He is the one we have to do with. He is the one we are dealing with. He is the one who can provide and does provide. Without his provision, you will not even be feeling well to go and work. You can enter a doctor's office when you are coming out. What you heard there, you can't work again. Yes. If you are young, you will not know what I'm saying. It's real. So remember that the master key, are you listening?
Yes.
Is seek ye first the kingdom of God, and to always be, no matter the work you are doing, no matter the course you are doing, you seek God even when you are in school. I'm not against school. I cannot be against school. I believe in school because I went to school. And I see a difference between people who go to school and those who don't go to school. That is why even those who did not take school seriously and come to an Akazo Bible school, we try to give you the equivalent of a university experience that maybe you didn't get in the secular world. We try to give you that experience here. That is our aim.